Okay, so there are 12 notes, and we name those notes with letters. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. That's 7 of them. What about the other 5? Well, in between those notes, most of those notes, are the rest of those notes, the other 5. And here's how that works. Between A and B, there's A sharp and B flat. That's actually one note. A sharp and B flat are the same thing, just 2 different names for it. Later on, in future lessons, we'll talk about why there would be different names for them, but for now, just think about it as A sharp or B flat. Then between B and C, there are no extra notes. It's just B to C. We'll talk about why that would be also in future lessons. Between C and D, there's C sharp and D flat. Between D and E, there's D sharp and E flat. Between E and F, it's kind of like B and C. There's nothing in between them. It's just E to F. Then from F to G, there's F sharp and G flat. And then after G, it actually wraps back around back to A where it starts over again. So between G and A, there's G sharp and A flat. Then after G sharp, you get back to A again and it starts over and you have all the same 12 notes in the next octave. And octave is just a word that we use to describe that group of 12 notes because it actually starts over again at A and then it's all the same notes, just like a higher version of the same notes. So this is A. But this is also A. And so is this. They're just in different octaves. It sounds like A, just a higher or lower version of them. And that's how all of this works, is that it's the same 12 notes over and over again, higher or lower. And that actually is what explains the fact that, obviously on the banjo, there are a lot more frets and strings and combinations of notes than 12. It's just that it's the same 12 notes in a bunch of different octaves. Speaking of the banjo, how do you know where those notes actually are on the banjo? Well, lucky for us, fretted instruments are actually pretty simple when it comes to figuring out where each note is. Let's just start with the first string, which on a 5-string banjo is generally tuned to D. If we're thinking about that open string as D, each fret after that is just the next note in that system of 12 notes. So obviously we have D, then we have D sharp or E flat for the first fret, for the second fret we have E, for the third fret we have F, for the fourth fret F sharp or G flat, for the fifth fret we have G, and so on, all the way up to the 12th fret where we get back to D again. You just use one note per fret. You don't skip a note, you don't skip a fret. You just keep going with that system and you'll get all of them. And then once you get to the 12th fret, you're back at D again, so it starts over. The 13th fret would be, again, D sharp or E flat. The 14th would be E. The 15th would be F. And it goes in the same system, just in the next octave. And it works exactly the same with each string. You can start from the open note of any of these strings on the banjo, and if you count one note per fret, you can find out what any note is on the banjo pretty easily. But here's the problem. If you did that, if you went through every note on the banjo with this system, even just up to the 12th fret, you'd end up with something that looks like this. And I don't know about you, but I don't find this particularly helpful. I'm not really interested in a chart with this much information that I have to look at or try to memorize and try to bring that to the banjo. That's really just not a practical way to go about things. I don't have this grid memorized, at least not in this way, and I think most musicians don't really think about the notes on their instrument in this way, in this all-encompassing grid of all the notes at the same time. Hey, sorry, I'm just gonna interrupt this video real quick to let you know that this video is sponsored by me. That's right, I'm sponsoring my own video. If you're interested in banjo tablature, backup examples, practice tips, basically a lot of banjo content that you can't find here on YouTube, then you should check out patreon.com/EliGilbertBanjo. That's where I post everything that you can't find here on YouTube, and it's also a great way to support the work that I'm doing here. Other than that, if you could just subscribe to this channel and like this video, that's also a huge way that you can help me make more of these videos. So if you do that, I really appreciate it. Anyway, back to the lesson. Now, don't get me wrong, I know where all the notes are on the fretboard. If you just pick a random note, I'm immediately gonna know that's A flat. That's no real problem. It's just that in my mind, it doesn't look like that grid. I don't have it memorized in quite that way. So then let's address 2 things. First of all, what's the value of the information we have so far? Basically, what the note names are, how you can find them on the fretboard, and then how do you organize that information so that it's actually useful? How do you just know where things are, no problem? Well, first of all, with the information we already have, it's still useful to be able to, for instance, just count from open G up to C and say G, G sharp, A sharp, B, C, and just know that you can figure that out. That is actually pretty useful. Partially because you're not always gonna know all the information you need to do things the easiest way possible, but you are always gonna wanna be able to figure out how to do something. I remember when this was all I knew about music theory and notes and harmony and all of that stuff, well, I still wanted to figure stuff out, so this was my best option. And I'm intentionally leaving other information for other lessons so that you can actually experience that work of moving around the fretboard, trying to figure things out, counting your way through all these notes, getting used to what notes are actually next to each other, you know, what comes after D sharp and, you know, is there a note between B and C? That kind of stuff is actually pretty useful to have some experience just working your way through the instrument. So I actually think it is a good idea to maybe just count your way all the way up a string a couple times, or just pick a random note and say, what is that? And count your way up to it. Because if you do that, then there's actually a pretty important way of moving around the fretboard that then becomes available to you. Let's take a note that you're gonna play all the time as a bluegrass banjo player, G. There's a lot of different places you can play it, but obviously you're probably gonna play it here, the open third string, pretty often. You're gonna play the open fifth string pretty often. You'll probably also play the fifth fret on the first string pretty often. There are a lot of times that you're gonna play the note G in different positions, which means if you know that that's the note G, you'll get really used to where that is. And if you ever wanna find the note G, well, it'll happen really, really fast. And you might not know where all of the other notes are really, really fast, but let's say you're looking for a place to play the note A flat, which if you'll remember is right next to G. You might look at the fretboard and say, I don't know where A flat is, but if you know where G is, then you know that you're one fret away from A flat. So if you're looking for an A flat on the first string, well, you probably know where a G is on the first string. So A flat is just one fret higher. Or if you don't even know that, if you just know that the open G string is G, then you know that you're one fret away from A flat. And that's pretty huge, because if you can come up with some sort of system for yourself of how to move around the fretboard and do these little tiny math equations to figure out where to find a note, then you're gonna be able to figure stuff out on your own. And I actually like being able to look at the fretboard and seeing some kind of weird geometry where you can see that there are certain patterns for how notes line up with each other. Like, this is kind of obvious, but D, the fourth string, is the same as D on the first string, just in two different octaves. So you can also think of every note that you're gonna play on those two strings is also an octave apart. So for instance, G on the fourth string is an octave away from G on the first string. It's the same note. That's actually kind of cool, because it means anything I play all over the neck, I know that those are gonna be the same. Even if that's all you know, just the concept of an octave, that those are the same notes an octave apart, you can find all kinds of interesting patterns and ways of looking at that. For instance, what about this? The fourth string on the fifth fret, that's the note G. And what about on the eighth fret on the second string? Also G, it's an octave apart. Well, this shape where you play a note on the fourth string, you skip the third string, and then you go up three frets on the second string, that's an octave, that's true everywhere. So it's just another way that you can look at this octave thing, or look at different ways to find notes that you're looking for. And another way you can think about all this stuff is that it all kind of resets after the 12th fret. We start down here, and then by the time we get to the 12th fret, everything starts over because that's the next octave. So that means that anything you play down here, if you move it 12 frets higher, it'll be the same thing up an octave. If you know this G chord, and you move it up 12 frets, it's the same chord up an octave, which I don't know about you, but actually it kind of demystifies a lot of things that people play up here. Because if you move that down 12 frets, it's basically just that G chord. There's something about playing up here that seems mysterious and confusing, but it's usually kind of the same shapes and information as you would play all the way down at this side of the neck, which for some reason feels more comfortable because we do it more often. And here's the deal. I know we're trying to do a lot with not that much information. We're trying to figure out where all the notes are, trying to figure out octaves, or just moving around the fretboard. And all we really know is note names and where they are on the fretboard. The thing is, it is actually a lot easier to do this with scales and chords and a bigger understanding of music theory. What we have now is just the basic fundamentals of what notes are. But if you can just take this and build some experience moving around the neck and just figuring out what things are, then it's gonna be a lot easier to learn about scales and chords. So here's kind of my practical advice, maybe homework before the next music theory lesson. you should take a look at the things that you're already playing and try to figure out what notes you're playing. Maybe you play a bunch of different chords, and you don't actually know what notes are in them. Well, using this system, you could figure out what notes are in each chord. Or you can take songs that you're playing and just try to figure out what notes it is that you're actually playing. Especially in the beginning, when you're playing bluegrass, you're playing a lot of the same notes because you're playing a lot of the same songs in the same keys. So you're getting really familiar with where certain notes are. It's pretty common for people to understand all the notes down here in the first 3 or 4 or 5 frets pretty quickly. So you might as well get started on that now. Is this a groundbreaking change to the way that you play banjo? Probably not, but the equivalent is kind of like if I explained something to you and you had to look through a dictionary every time just to figure out what I was talking about, instead of just knowing what I'm saying, in the future, when I talk about these notes and where they are on the fretboard and what positions I'm using, you want to be able to just be there and not have to think about it too much. One of the misconceptions that people have about music theory is that it's something you think about while you play music. To me, music theory is something that I use to build new patterns in my brain so I don't have to think while I'm playing, because I don't really want to be thinking all that much when I'm playing music. I want to be using my ear, and my experience with music theory can guide that. So do yourself a favor and build that experience now so that in the future, you have a foundation that we can build on easily. And if you're interested in a bonus practice tip where I talk about some of the other ways that I think about the fretboard, just some of my own personal fretboard geography stuff, then again, feel free to check out patreon.com. Please subscribe to this channel, like this video, all that stuff. But otherwise, that's going to do it for this one. I'll see you next time.